This sonata you're going to play is considered to be one of Beethoven's best piano pieces?
I think one of his greatest. Mm-hmm. I think it's probably his most sublime.
Sublime, that is a sort of spiritual quality that you suggest
yes.
there.
I think after all the troubles, all his tragic examples of problems in life, his loss of hearing, you get to a stage whereby I feel that he could see over the side of the mountain, not just admire the front of the mountain. Mm. And I think in this work you get the gradual eradication of all these problems and the replacement of something which is so serene and so deep and so long-lasting that I think it takes an equal contribution from the audience as from the performer.
It isn't really very well known. It isn't, for instance, as well, nothing like as well known as Moonlight or Pathétique.
No.
Now, why not, though? Why not?
Because it's not as much an instant work with regard to its appeal. It takes more than one performance to really have it felt in one's bones. Mm. It's, I think, one of those works which you really need to hear a good number of times and to live with without even hearing it before you can make an accurate assessment. And there are parts of it which will never really be fully understood by any musician or any person.
Is that... Now then, what is its difficulty, though, if that's the case? I mean, is it... It's not that it's difficult to play. It's not just a technical thing you're talking about, is it?
No, but it's to do with the fact that the most important things in life are those which are least obvious. And the most important things in life are those which are least tangible and often least profit-making. And therefore, there's least accentuation on those values. And with works like this, you do get them. But unfortunately, they don't instantly sell. Mm. And therefore, you hear them all the less because of it. It's a great pity.
But you never expect to really fully appreciate a piece of music on hearing it once, do you?
It depends on the piece. If it's a simple bit of pop music, you can like it straight away. Mm. And then if you keep on hearing it, you may like it less and less. Mm. But conversely, there are pieces of music which you don't like quite so much on the first hearing, and you like them more and more. Mm. It's like human relationships.
I was just
like
going
all
to say, people you meet sometimes on first impression very good, and then they dwindle, and sometimes a difficult person improves.
That's right. Very often it's empty cans make the most noise and so on.
When you mentioned pop a second ago, though, it reminded me of the fact that in the sonata there is a strikingly, well, what I would call a jazz-like sound, yet this piece was written 160 years ago.
Yeah.
Well, is jazz-like a good description?
Well, it is. It's exactly the basis of modern jazz rhythm, in the same way Beethoven invented rock and roll, but a lot of people are prepared not to admit that. Mm. The last part of his Seventh Symphony is pure rock and roll rhythm. People think all this is new, but in fact Beethoven was very much the originator of all these things.
Mm. Well, what is it? Why is it that an unmusically trained person like myself, however, could pick up the jazz sound of it?
I mean, well, that's purely a rhythmic thing.
I mean, rhythmic.
I don't think you're that untrained as you make out. You seem extremely musical from the chat we've had before, and I think that you probably do yourself down in that respect.
Well, I'm certainly not trained in a musical way.
No, but I don't think you need to be trained to appreciate music. I think a lot of people I meet after concerts, they don't know anything about the writing of music, the technicalities, but they can be emotionally moved by it just as much as somebody who is musically trained, if not more so. Mm. Sometimes you meet a musical theorist, or he may be a professor of music, and he or she might be really quite cool, intellectually powered, but without anything there, you know?
Mm. Was Beethoven, to go back to that business of the jazz, was he sort of ahead of his time in terms of new rhythms then? Is that a considered thing about him?
Well, of course he was ahead of his time, because he was probably the world's greatest genius in music. And as a result, you know, what is a genius is time. He's without time, isn't he? Or she's without time. Mm. I think in his case, he was a master of all forms of evolutionary ideas regarding rhythm, but also melody and harmony and form and everything. Mm. His music is, for that reason, tremendously hard to interpret, because it's without limit. And he is so great because it's so lofty on one hand and yet so humorous on the other. Mm. I mean, he represents all forms of life in his music.
And when he wrote this particular sonata you're going to play, he was actually totally deaf.
Yes, he was. He had to when he conducted, he had to be turned round to see people clapping at the end, rather than just being able to hear it. And he wasn't able to hear what the musicians were playing while he was conducting.
But, well, let me ask you this then. Could you play Beethoven deaf, if you were deaf?
Having heard and having learnt the music while I could hear, probably yes. But I would need to have heard first. I think in this work there was an example of inner hearing from him, because towards the end of this very sublime second movement, you get big gaps between the second and the right hand, the left and the right hands.
Yes.
And they are filled in by his imaginary hearing. And in fact, we must use our own inner hearing to do the same thing when we recreate it.
Well, do you mean that when your hands are far apart, that there is a gap for you musically?
No, that gap has to be filled in by your inner hearing. Mm. And so it is to the people that hear it today. Mm. I think it's very important to realise that this was written by somebody who couldn't hear. But the audience must also make a strong effort to use their inner hearing, which everyone has to a greater or less degree.
Mm. So it's his inner hearing he was hearing when he was deaf. Mm.
But I want to emphasise the underlying point of this work is not misery. It's nothing which is sad or depressed. It is sublime, it is serious, but it goes beyond emotion into something which is tremendously optimistic.
Well, by the time he'd coming to the end of his life, Beethoven had, funnily enough, he was very bitter at one point and very frightened of dying, wasn't he? But towards the end, he became very serene, would that be the word? Or contented, or what?
Yes, content is a closer word. Mm. He just had great peace of mind in the knowledge that he not only accounted for all his problems and had to succumb to them, and those problems were very great, but he also showed everyone what the result is of having successfully overcome a challenge or a problem which can be tragic. Mm. In his case, he considered suicide after he became deaf, but in fact, by succumbing to that tragedy and overpowering it, he showed to everybody that it's not so much whether you receive hardship or tragedy, it's the way you react to it that matters. Mm.
Before we listen to you playing, can you tell me what you feel when you say play the sonata you're going to play?
Well, first of all, I must say that whenever I play any piece of music, it's totally, not totally, but somewhat different each time you play it. Mm. So therefore, the experience I shall have playing this work now will be quite different from a performance I may have made of it a month ago. Mm. Having said that, there are similar guidelines. And in fact, if I could give you the words that would account for my feelings, I would do so straight away. But in fact, music begins where words stop, and it's very difficult to highlight very deep musical feeling and concentration in simple words. I wish I had the words to account for those feelings.
Well, of course, if a musician had the words, he'd write rather than he would compose, presumably.
But I suggest people just listen for themselves and let the waves of the music pass over them, and for them to use their imagination more than actually trying to ascribe words to the music, because I think words stop long before music does. Mm. But I may be just healthily prejudiced towards music.